Welcome, everyone. Gives me a really great pleasure to be here this afternoon and share some learning with you. One of those going to learn a lot of new definition, a lot of very important, yes, please, very important words that connected to each other. Let's have it, and I think at least a few seconds we should go over the list. Why I highly recommend you to go over some of these books or all of them. Since we are going to experience a different point of view in regards to divine inspiration and prophecy, you read between the lines these four main religion or faith group a different approach. For example, Thomas Aquinas, the Summa Theologies, is crucial to understand the general terms that we're going to discuss today. Other books here are basically the foundation of our talk today. So again, if you get a chance, either spend time to read all or some of these books. William Shakespeare, in his very famous Macbeth, described beautifully the whole concept of divine inspiration and prophecy. Try to describe in the simple way the story of Julius Caesar and how all this inspiration turned around and changed the mind, the character. The reason I'm sharing this, say, very well-known Shakespeare point, it's because we're going to share a important word that used almost everywhere. And I'm almost positive that for many of you it's a new definition. But the moment you conceptualize this definition, I strongly believe that you get a foundation of Buddhism, definitely Christianity and Judaism, but even Islam and the Sufi part, the mystical part of Islam, will be better understood. The word is called theurgy. How many of you heard that word? One, two, three, four. Theurgy, for those who are not so familiar, as a definition, it means the ability of a person, of a creature, to influence the supernatural power. Meaning, since the three major religions, Islam, Christianity, and Judaism, believe that there is a omnipotence, the supernatural power, to change his or her, in our definition, mind. It is like a person go to a minister or priest or sheikh or rabbi, and he or she asked for help, for prayer, for someone who's in New Zealand. So in the Greek philosophy, they ask a simple question, how that happened? In the world of computers, in the new communication revolution, looks simple. You can click on the internet and send an email, send a fax. In those ancient times, in Greek writing, they used the word theurgy, which basically by definition is from the Greek, some said Latin. It's the idea that a person is a God creature, and since he or she is a God creature, they are basically able to influence God the same way as God is able to influence them. And because of that, it's a belief that the person in his ability can, in a sense, talk to the supernatural power and make him or her by their supplication, by their words, to change the supernatural power decision elsewhere. It's a deep thought. It's a deep idea. But first and foremost, we need to understand the definition. Theurgy is the concept of duality. Duality meaning that God and people are partners. Professor Herschel put it in a simple writings in his book, God in Search of Man, or Man is Not Alone. In these two books, he explains that there is some sort of partnership between the omnipresent, the omnipotent, and people. With that in mind, we can ask the very famous question. Who has the right, or who owns the ability of prophecy? Who has the idea of some type of divine inspiration that can, in a way, prognosticate the future, can prophesize what's going to happen? How in the world you and I, or someone else, have the clairvoyant ability to change something above nature, to create something that either that person make it or something above a person make a change elsewhere in the world? So first we need to know the definition. The theological definition means that we have some power because we are God, and meaning we have some spark of God, and because we have that part, we have the ability to communicate with the big God, with the big part, and influence that one to do something in the world, can be in our own life or can be elsewhere. Is that clear? Okay. So with that in mind, we can go to the next step. The next step is, since we are basically seeing the picture of something that it's called the Beloved, or Allah, or God, or Lord, or all kind of different names, then how exactly the system works. In Buddhism, it's much simpler. As you remember, we talk in Buddhism about the three important items, the three mantras, in order to develop the state of nirvana. Do you remember that? So one of them is the idea that nothing has itself, that everything is connected and nothing has its own entities, which means everything connected to the others. So everything is impermanent and nothing is by itself. Therefore, nirvana is quiescence, right? You remember we talked about it? So in that sense, in Buddhism, it's relatively simple, since it's everything connected to everything. So regardless if you call it God, you call it other names, the ability of people to be enlightened and change the world is relatively simple. The religion, in the sense of the three major religions, dealing with the question of theurgy, which means how far God has influenced a person's life and how far a person can quote-unquote control God or can change God's decision, is a very deep, serious question that involves in a very different phases. One of them, you see to this very day, people, especially leaders in the world and other people, expresses their prophecy. They said, that's what's going to happen. You can question that. You can say either they are right or they may be charlatans. Either they are correct or maybe they are really vindictive, evil people. But the point is, each of them, at least to their constituencies, to their people, preach some type of divine prophecy or divine inspiration. So what's going to happen? We're going to visit these four different faith group, or you call them, for that sense we can call them religion, but it's a different approach, the whole concept of divine inspiration and prophecy. I would like to start with Maimonides, the famous Rambam, the great man that was not only a philosopher and writer and rabbi, he was also a very famous physician. He was hired by the Salah ad-Din, which was the ruler of Egypt at that time. and he wrote extensively books of philosophy and books of science in his time, 12th century. Maimonides, or in the acronym Rambam, which is the abbreviation of his name, Moshe ben Maimon, he described in his book, God for the Perplexed, at length the whole concept of prophecy. Who exactly is a prophet? And how a person can become or has the ability of prophecy? Is that something that is preconditioned? Or it's something that is just happened by itself? It's something that it's the, which you call God of the world, or God, or Lord, or whatever it is, chosen someone? Or it's something that relates to a just a coincidence or a person's life? That question that Rambam came to this to bring us a discussion has some background. For sure, the basic background is the teaching of Aristotle, the Aristotelian teaching. The whole concept of Aristotelian teaching is the teaching that a person needs to go to a certain suffering or certain life challenges to take away his materialistic world, to go through a certain process of cleansing in order for him or her to receive some type of divine prophecy. That school of thought is not only Aristotelian, is not only Aristotle speaks about. There are many others who follow that way of thinking. Earlier than Aristotle, you see it in the writings of Philo and others, who speak about afflicted self-suffering by a person itself in order to receive some type of divine inspiration. Maimonides, however, strongly disagree with that opinion. He hold, and he brought many biblical stories, that a person can be absolutely an evil man and can receive a great divine inspiration or prophecy, and a person can be a great man and try all his life to be close to whatever you call God and does not receive prophecy. Therefore, he said that I agree with the Aristotle teaching that a person should limit his materialism. By the same token, it still depends on the, which he called the divine, to bring upon a person a divine inspiration and prophecy. As I assume you know, the great Maimonides, the Rambam, wrote many books. There are many hospitals, this is one of them, named after him, worldwide. So we're not talking about just another great scholar, we're talking about a giant scholar that extensively writes about prophecy. You see in your paper the famous chapter 37 in the book of Ezekiel. Chapter 37 in the book of Ezekiel is a very heavy chapter, because that chapter dealing with the whole concept of resurrection. I don't have to tell you, you are a very intelligent audience, so you know that the most believe in that prophecy is the Christianity, particularly Catholicism, but also Protestants. They believe very strongly in that idea of prophecy, whatever the interpretation is. What is that prophecy all about? Is the prophet Ezekiel, who lived about 170 years before destruction of the first temple, which is about 300 BCE. And he has some type of vision. We don't know what type of vision, but he said, I saw God in a vision, which we need to discuss. What does that mean? And he described in the vision a great valley, and in that valley he saw a dead bodies, and then all of a sudden, those dead bodies, those bones, turned around and resurrected and became as a human being. So this prophecy of the idea of resurrection of the dead became such a mantra in so many faith groups that the book of Ezekiel became a focal point of discussion, not only among the ancient Talmudic sages, but also in many other religions as well. Yes, in the Talmud itself, there are an opinion that that prophecy happened, There are others who say that it will happen. Maimonides hold that Ezekiel has such a theological ability to communicate with the highest power, which he called the level 11, which we need to discuss, that Ezekiel received such a prophecy that he really talked about something that will happen in the future. What exactly he's speaking about? He's talking about a prophecy of some great war. They call it Magog and Gog, or Gog and Magog. It's a great war around the world. And in that war, unfortunately, by that prophecy and other prophecy, part of the world disappeared. And after that great war, it will be a time of resurrection, which means it will be a time of huge change in the world. And part of that change is the idea that those people who already no longer among the living will be able to resurrect and live again. How that happened? So the whole idea of Ezekiel prophecy is from the point of departure that the book of Genesis speaks about God formulating human being and blew in man's nostrils the soul of life and make him or her a living being. And right after that, there is a sentence in the book of Leviticus that speaks about two sons of Aaron that fire came from heaven and blew toward the nostrils and took away their lives. And as you know, disconnecting a respirator from a person is basically created a natural death in the sense that the person cannot breathe, cannot live. So the whole idea of that omnipresent, that great God that created its creatures, he and his will were resurrected, those selected or everyone or whatever the theology involved in that. But there is a lot of school of thought what Ezekiel meant in his book. Why it's so crucial? Because it's estimated about 2 billion people in the world believe in that prophecy. So we have to talk about it, since you may doubt it or you may think that it's not realistic and not true, but it's something that Maimonides spent years of writing trying to explain what it's all about. So here is the one example I'd like to share with you. It's a very current event, in a sense, example. But this is something that we need to talk. What exactly divine inspiration and prophecy, and how that happened? Who has the right to prophecy, and who has the right to divine inspiration? If you tell me that all those biblical sources are just, you know, some sources that has nothing to do with life, the next question is, you see a world leader that have all kind of statements over quote-unquote prophecy or divine inspiration. And we cannot treat it lightly, because it's not a 10 million or 100 million, but it's a billion sometimes of people that believe in the word that they are saying. So if we take an example, the Pope, the current one of his not long ago statement is as follows. Okay? Simple. Our Christian conviction is that Christ is also the Messiah of Israel. Certainly it is in the hands of God how and when the unification of Jews and Christians into the people of God will take place. So basically the Pope saying here, he is basically having some type of prophecy. He has, at least to his people, at least to those people who follow that teaching, it will be a time of resurrection, it will be a time of Christ coming, or whatever you call it, and at that time, this is going to happen. Now, regardless to level of believing the divine prophecy in the sense, this is a public statement that was made. So again, this is not something we can take lightly. We have to talk about it. The next example, I'm going to share with you several examples of different world leaders. So as we said earlier, it's not just a just obstructive discussion over divine inspiration and prophecy, it's a lot of application to our times. Let's see some other examples. This is a quote from one of the great bishops. That's what he said, word by word. In the New Testament, prophecy is referred to as one of the spiritual gifts given by the indwelling Holy Spirit, which again, this is a big question what he meant. From this, many Christians believe that the gift of prophecy is the supernatural ability to receive and convey a message from God. The purpose of the message may be to, quote, edify, exhort, and comfort the members of the church. In that context, right, this context, not all prophecies contain predictions about the future, right? It's also teaching that the first doctrine that prophecy is for the benefit of the whole church and not just the individual exercising the gift. Again, the end statement is a very interesting statement, because in this statement, basically what they're saying, that not only the priest or minister can be just lay people or anybody in that sense can have the gift of prophecy. And again, so whom do you count on, or whom do you really trust in that sense? Who has that ability? The task of prophetic Christian ministry is to nurture, nourish, and evoke the consciousness and prescription alternative to the consciousness and perception of the dominant culture. A recognized form of Christian prophecy is the, quote, prophetic drama, which describes as the metaphorical conjunction between a mess up copying, right, present situations and future events. This is another beautiful example. Do you recognize those faces? You sure? 100%? Okay. Anybody knows about any divine inspiration and prophecy that any one of them said? The point is, many people ask that question, who started the war first, and what's the war going to happen, and how? Who is going to attack whom? Is Israel going to attack first, or Iran is going to attack first, and how it's going to happen? But what is the real concern, we may laugh here in 2012 Florida, but people around the world are not laughing over different statements that made, especially statements that contributed to something bigger than just me, but the divine talked to me. I have a divine inspiration, I have a prophecy. Do you know what type of divine inspiration prophecies they claim? So let's see. An example. This is what he said. Do you know how many millions of people believe in these statements? If you're not concerned about it, I'll worry, but to me it's a serious concern. For example, the statement like they invaded Iraq and Afghanistan during 9/11 as a pretext. This is a statement, very famous statement, that Ahmadinejad said. A political and power-seeking network claimed to be advocates for one group of the victims and sought reparations for the blood. This network ruled that the survivors of this particular group of victims must receive compensation, and part of this compensation was the established Zionist regime in the land of Palestine. On this pretext, they attacked Palestine, and after massacring the indigenous people and driving them from their homes, they occupied the homeland and created a Zionist regime in order to ensure that this no regional power will emerge into Islamic lands, except for the West, because Islamic civilization, culture, have the dynamic potential to threaten their interests, which are based on operation and thirst for power. These principles and philosophy comprise the Zionist regime. People around the world are fully aware of what is happening in occupied Palestine. Women and children are being murdered. You see the words? At the same time, occupier, which does not abide by any principle, and terror is part of the pronounced and routine policy enjoy the support of the previously mentioned governments. Let me be blunter. State terrorism is being supported by those who claim to fight terrorism. Say that the World War II, the story of Holocaust, is a myth. That's another interesting statement. Israel and the United States will soon be destroyed. That's his prophecy. That's his divine inspiration. United States and the Zionist regime of Israel will soon come to the end of their lives. See the last statement? It's a very strong statement. The belief that people in the West created the friction between the Shia and the Sunnah, and it's all planted in advance, right? And that's his prophecy. So this is the question. Who owns divine inspiration and prophecy? Is that something we take lightly? No. There are many people who claim that they have the divine prophecy and they have the inspiration and they know what's going to happen. And if we take these statements lightly, then we doom, in a sense, to a very bad future. So the big question is, do we just say that there are very selected people who basically godly people are able to predict the future, or this is something that everyone can predict? I don't have to tell you that as a veteran of war, I was asked in endless times, prediction, what's going to happen and how it's going to happen. So does that mean I know better than the others? I maybe have some experience, but I don't think I'm a prophet. However, you see many people who claim that they know what's going to happen. In Judaism, Maimonides' theory contained two elements. One, explanation of what prophecy is. And two, a ranking of various types of prophecy, like phenomena. In A Guide for the Perplexed, he explains the basically 11, some call it 12, but it's basically 11 levels of prophecy. What exactly makes a person a prophet? According to A Guide for the Perplexed, which is a very controversial book, in chapter 56 he tried to describe prophecy. So he can say that it's like inspire action, inspire all word, happen through the dream, happen through a vision, revelation, human speaker, etc. But this is a very sensitive subject. You remember Shabtai Tzvi? Our subject of 2 weeks ago. It happens that some charlatans say that I have a divine inspiration. Or some people have some type of imaginations and they think that that's a divine inspiration. So it's a very sensitive subject. Here Maimonides comes to a picture, and unlike Aristo, he said, even a person struggle all his life and he may deserve to have divine inspiration. As long as the one who inspired not gave him that inspiration, it's not going to happen. Another point he tried to say that if inspiration happened, there are different levels of inspiration. But the big question is, with that said and done, how will that apply to our lives? If someone has some type of inspiration, You sleep at night and you wake up and you see your loved one that no longer among the living, and they tell you something. Or you see some inspiration doing whatever it is, some experience, some enlightenment in your life. Here is an example. He claimed, the one who's no longer among the living, the father of the one who's now the ruler. That's their inspiration. So you know, several days ago, it was a very beautiful trick they played. They sent a missile, and on purpose, something was messed up missile in order to some people to misevaluate their ability. But regardless of that, it's the whole idea of test missile technology that basically have some ideas, some prophecy. It's a belief, not only the ruler of the Iran said, but North Korea as well, they have some type of prophecy. In Buddhism, it's very important to know, since we talk about four phases of different, this is a very important part of Buddhism. This is a formal statement, a formal story, and basically that when they talk about royal seal, that's the ancient part of Buddhism, right? And it talks about 527. Fulfillment of that prophecy, the earth shook, the sun was darkened, beautiful flower rained from the sky. So again, in Buddhism, they're very strongly in the belief of theurgy, which means there is a school of thought that speaks about two contradictions. One is called the homo religiosus, and the other one is called the cognitives. Anybody heard about it? Okay. Homo religiosus, it means that the person is part of the culture, part of the society, and is not separating himself from the community. For example, if you talk about church, so you are part of the community of the church, and you're part of the worshippers, and you're just one of those flock that follow. Cognitive person is someone who has the ability to disassociate himself from doctrine, which means he can be part of the doctrine, but he kept his or her individuality while they are part of the doctrine. So this duality, this combination of the two, which is being homo religiosus and cognitive, that's not only Martin Buber, big writings, but you see it in Franz Rosenzweig, you see it in many other scholars, that a person can be both. In this sense, a person can be individual, but since he's a creator of the biggest enlightenment, so he can be connected to the Buddhism, they call it the biggest in, or the big Dharma of itself, and he reached the state of nirvana that can change the world. That's the nirvana that is quiescent. It means, by this teaching, in conjunction to Maimonides' teaching, Maimonides explained in the very beginning of his book of science, since the unlimited is the omnipresent, is unlimited. And that nature of the unlimited created creatures that are limited. The limited, it's limited, because it's created limited. So the limited will never be able to understand or control the unlimited because it's created limited. And therefore the limited are able to comprehend or understand, construing or influence the unlimited as long as he's in a state of mind that he is limited and the one who created him is unlimited. The problem is when the limited try to control the unlimited, then it turned the disappointment or situation of illusion because he's not comprehending his limitation that he was created limited. Is that clear? Woo! You want me to repeat? Okay. Use of simple language. Okay. If God is everything in that sense, is the omnipresence, all right, is unlimited. If you have a manufacturer, and someone is a manufacturing something, he's the inventor, right? He created the product. You have a product. The product is the product of the one who created the product. So it's somehow it's part of the original product. In that sense, the divine has a small spark in every creature. Since that creature is part of the divine, they are in some ways our partners. Why? Because the divine created that creature, and that creature could not be created without the divine. Clear? So therefore, that small spark of divine has some divine ability. As long as that small spark understands that he or she are small and limited. With that small spark, there can be such a great brightness that can influence the big part, which is unlimited. But again, with understanding that they are limited. Is that clear now? Thank you. Okay, so we ask a question. Who owns divine inspiration and prophecy? Take the other side of the world. Here's the prophecy. And that's a very serious prophecy because so many millions believe in that. That's what he said. You can be disgusted, you can be angry, you can say it's all belonging, but you have millions of people that believe that that's the prophecy. That's what's happening. That's the inspiration. It's a very strong claim, by the way. Recently, in the Arab world, the Supreme Guide of the Muslim Brotherhood is just recently elected. Look what he said. Government's trying to stop Muslims from fighting the US, disregarding Allah commandment. You see, they're taking God as part of their themes, right? Allah commandment to wage jihad for his sake with their money and their lives so that Allah's world and reach supreme over all non-Muslims. Another Islamic leader, look at his words. That's a very strong statement. He said, it is a divine prophecy. This is from the book of Revelation. This is a statement that one of the bishops in New York quoted, and that's the statement he used when he quoted that quotation from the book of Revelation, again from the New Testament. Again, taking a biblical text, and I will show you the judgment is going to come on the great prostitute who rules over many waters. What does that mean in the Bible? You see, my friends, using text or using Allah, it's a very dangerous path. It is like, in many ways, using electricity. Think about this beautiful room. We have air condition here, we have a sound system, it is in great shape. So electricity is a wonderful thing, it can create and enhance our life and make us very comfortable and very advanced. By the same token, electricity can be not only hazard, but can kill you. You agree with that? In that sense, words have the same power, the same as electricity. Words can make you great, words can kill. Words can kill. And words that contributed to a divine inspiration of prophecy, it's a very dangerous path. So that question, we not give up on that question. Who owns the divine inspiration of prophecy? Statement from the Islam. Muslims maintain that Prophet Muhammad experienced prophetic, remember this word, prophetic phenomena that equated with interpretation of dreams, vision, and remote viewing, which identify him as a prophet. Since we talk about using words, let me share with you four statements. And again, can be any leader at any generation, at any times, that say a statement. Can be a gorgeous, beautiful statement, can be evil statement, can be a great man with evil statement, can be a horrible man with very great statement that looks to people like a divine prophecy. Let's examine these four statements and hold on and figure out who said those statements. Wasn't long ago. Anyone volunteer to read the first statement, please? Someone who has a big voice? Please, Tavi.
The art of leadership consists in consolidating the attention of the people against a single adversary and taking care that nothing will split up that attention.
Very nice. Next one, please. You can continue.
Through clever and constant application of propaganda, people can be made to see paradise as hell and also the other way around. To consider the most wretched sort of life as paradise.
Interesting statement. What do you think so far? It's a stupid or wise statement? Go to the third one. What do you think about this statement? Let's go the last time. As soon as
by one's own propaganda, even a glimpse of right on the other side is omitted, the cause for doubting one's own right is made.
Okay. Raise your hand if you know who said those statements, please. If you know for sure who said those statements, raise your hand.
Is it one person?
One person. If you know, don't say it, just raise your hand. Since no one raised his or her hand, just raise your hand if you think you know. Don't guess. Just tell me if you know, you raise your hand. No? Okay. Next question. Does anyone agree with those statements, or anyone think that it's wise statement, prophetic statement, inspiring statement, or not? What do you think?
No.
What?
No.
No? Anybody think that those statements are prophetic statement, divine inspiration statement?
Yes.
You think that it's a divine?
Divine inspiration, the reality.
Reality. Okay. Anybody else? What is your name?
Lord.
Okay. Anybody else agree? What do you think about this statement? Just raise your hand if you have opinion. Don't say who said it if you're not sure.
It's a matter of controlling other people.
It's a matter of controlling other people. That's a very bright statement. Do you know who said it? You don't know. Do you have any opinion over these statements? What do you feel about those statements? Alright. Possible. Yes?
In Yiddish, an expression called Mishagas.
I wish that it's so simple and likely. Yes?
It has a certain level of reality.
Has certain level of reality that makes it dangerous. Okay. How about this third statement? Yes?
When you say man myself is a cheat or what?
Okay. You want me to tell you who said it? Shh, no, God forbid. No. Shh. You'll be surprised. It's direct quotation. I'm not making any one of them. It's word by word of his quotation. Yes?
The other thing that really what sort of frightens me about some of it is that you can lose your sense of identity, your sense of, like the last one, you start doubting yourself, you're losing your sense of knowing who you are because we're very much swayed by, and I think by the media, by truth. What is the real truth? So we're, our own personal truth can be really affected by that. We're not really stronger than our truth.
All right. Very interesting, Tali. So what she said, for those who didn't hear her, she said you have your own set of truth, your own set of mind of what is truth. Yes, please. This is one of the world leaders in the past generation. Yes, very influential leader. Very, very influential leader. You want to know who is the leader and what is his name?
Yes.
Word by word, what was he said? Word by word, what he said? All right? Three examples. When he was about to assassinate during World War, he said that the divine protected him. Second time, when he was about to assassinate him during the World War II, he said the divine protected him. And the third time, he was in a bunker. And he said, I have a divine voice that talked to me and said to me, you must leave the bunker immediately. And he left the bunker, and the bunker was right away bombed and demolished. And he said, you see how the divine protecting me, I have a divine inspiration, what is right for the world. Let's take a 5 minutes break. Thank you. Over current event, in conjunction to divine inspiration and prophecy. Before we go to more current people who claim some level of prophecy or divine inspiration, I would like to ask you a question. Who are the main prophets of the religion like Christianity? Who are the main prophets? Jesus, yes. Who else? All the prophets of the Old Testament, and who else? Also the popes. Who are the main prophets in Islam? For sure, beside of Muhammad, who else? The part of the Quran that connected to the Old Testament, and what else? Who else have the divine prophecy and inspiration in Islam?
Abraham.
For sure, all the ancients, but in our times it can be any spiritual leader. Can be imam, can be sheikh, can be ayatollah, etc. In Judaism, beside of the divine prophecy or divine inspiration and prophecy in the Bible, or in the entire canon of the Tanakh, who else have a prophecy that we consider it as a prophet? The answer is, after the Tanakh, after the biblical time, post-biblical time, the Talmud said that it's no longer prophecy. The moment the temple destroyed, anybody who said his prophet is wrong. There's no such a thing prophecy. If there's no temple, there's no prophecy. Which means, the Maimonides said, individuals can have a divine inspiration, but as far as the prophecy is concerned, someone constantly have those ancient message of God, according to Maimonides, it's not correct since the temple is no longer in existence. So we have the contemporary, this fellow, anybody recognize his name? What? Very famous. What? Nachnerson, no. No, no Baal Shem Tov. Baal Shem Tov is 204 years ago. This one lived, he passed away, if I'm not mistaken, at the 50s. It's not a leader of Hasidic sect. He was the chief rabbi of Palestine, the first chief rabbi of Palestine. His name is Cook. Anybody heard that name? Abraham Isaac Cook. What? Cook. Either K-O-O-K or...
K-O-O-K.
Or C-H? It's a different English pronunciation, but in Hebrew it's Kuf Vav Kuf. So he was the spiritual leader that many right wings worldwide believe in his school of thought. He basically talked about it before World War II. And then he lived in Palestine during the war and after the war. And he held this statement, again, very strong, and you can call it even dangerous, depending on how you look at this, but it's a very strong statement, which is connecting Jewish settlement in West Bank or all different places with what? With God as allotted to the Jewish people as outside of the Hebrew Bible, as an important step in the process of redemption. Now, he was the chief rabbi. It was at that time called Palestine, now it's called Israel, but that was his statement, and that, because of his inspiration and his son's inspiration, you see all these settlements in different locations. Either you are for the settlement or against the settlement. The idea of the divine inspiration behind those people who are doing all kinds of things, it's based on this theory that it's some type of prophecy, some type of divine inspiration. I knew that Tali would get excited over that, but it's okay.
It's going also back,
okay, so what Tali is saying is basically what, based off his inspiration in that sense, he said in a nice way, God talked to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, now God is talking to me and telling me to tell you that that's the reason for soon to be establishment of State of Israel. And part of that prophecy is to build settlement. You like it or dislike it, but that's what he taught and his son taught. Yes. Excellent. That's the question I'm asking.
What's the question?
She asked a question, what exactly is divine inspiration, or something that someone said to you, or something that is a real God message to the world? That's the question that every religion asks. That's the question that everyone asks. Who has the right? Who owns that right?
What's the answer?
Do we know the answer? If I know the answer, I'll not be here. I promise you. I don't think we have an answer for that. If we are really honest with that, we can present the issue, we can present the idea of divine inspiration and prophecy in our times. But to give an answer to that, it's like, whatever you said can be against the other three religion or three faith groups. Excellent point. So in the ancient time, in the biblical time, you have the ancient Bible that whatever you call it, the guy, God of the omnipresence or the Lord, picked up. Can be evil men like Balaam in the book of Numbers, can be great men like Moses in the Bible, okay? Can be different people. But since it's no longer a temple, so by Jewish faith, no one is a prophet, okay? In other words, people can have some type of inspiration and feeling and leadership, but as far as connecting the text with the common event is very dangerous.
Joan of Arc.
What?
Joan of Arc.
So some say that it's a prophecy. But again, anytime you define prophecy in 2011 to people, you're walking on a very dangerous path. That's what I try to tell you. That's what I said. In 2012, we don't know who is the real one. This is a secular Jew. I assume everyone knows, right? No, you don't. Okay. So let's read first what he said. Who is volunteer to read? Please, please. Number one, if you will it, please.
If you will it, it is not during the rehearsal. It goes without saying that the Jewish people can have no other goal than Israel, and that, whatever the fate of the proposition may be, our attitude toward the land of our fathers is and shall remain unchanged.
So this is, thank you, this is a secular Jew. At once in his life almost converted to Christianity. Theodor Herzl said, and for sure he is using a biblical text, like it or not, even he is not observant Jew, right? He's using the word land of our fathers. The minute you use that statement, you're basically talking about who? Not your father from 1850 or 1820, your grandfather, because he lived at that time, 1890. We talk about our ancestors. That's right. So he's basically as a secular Jew that disassociated himself most of his life from any part of practical Judaism, practice, ritual, or anything in Judaism. Yet he said, that's my dream, that's my prophecy. And he used in many of his speeches prophecy, which is the vision part, he is the key part of the state of Israel. In any flag or any sign of Magen David, you see his face. Right? Special university, a mountain, many things on his name. Okay? Now, here is it opposite than Cook in the philosophy of thinking, yet he presenting something that, in a sense, it's a divine prophecy for some people because it happens like a miracle, but it happens, no one basically believe it happened, it caused tremendous blood, etc., but it happens. So again, we ask that question, and you know what's the question. I don't even write it. Yes?
Has it been said that the devil can quote scripture?
Can you repeat it so everybody can hear you? Woo! Your name?
Leon.
Leon said, please, loud. I didn't say it, he said it. Okay, so what he said, that basically the devil or evil people can quote Bible for their needs, can be Islamic, Jewish, Christians, whatever, using scripture for their agenda. That's very common propaganda. Every religion, every faith, that's a very dangerous path to using a scripture for their personal need, because you take any narrative and you can play around with that narrative for your needs. It's a very dangerous path. And what I tried to prove to you in the previous lecture is to prove to you how many millions or tens of millions follow the trap of either can be a dictator or leader, whatever it is, that said something, and this is God's message, and this is a Allah message, or Bible message, etc. And you have tens, sometimes hundreds of millions that follow. In any religion. We talk today in these couple of lectures over four different faith or religion, whatever you call them. So it's a very serious, a dangerous path. Very, very dangerous path. Yes. Mariella, right?
Mariella.
Yes. Correct. Okay, she talked about who is going to lead you. But because we're soon running out of time, you remember that last week I shared with you one of my writings, and it was a memoir. For sure, it's a I change names and locations, first and foremost to get the Israeli censor's approval, which I got a couple of months ago. But it's basically a memoir of part of my life. And in that memoir, I use a narrative in trying to deal with those questions. One of the questions I present to you last week, for those who attend the lecture last week, is the story of this Michael, the key character, who went to this Rabbi Minsky and he gets for him a certificate of exemption. Do you remember that story? Good. Wait. So what happened, he went to this great rabbi, he exempted him an exemption from service, but he in his free will decided to give up that and go and fight. He was born, you can't change the situation, he was just born in a place that it's a war, he born in a situation with the fighting going on, and he was in a great predicament, a great dilemma, what to do, to be or not to be, to go to war, or to stay in the yeshiva and study. You remember all of that? And then he chooses. Today, I'm going another step with you. I'm going to share with you another part, but instead of hearing it, I ask some volunteer to read, not too much reading, just to give you a narrative of one of the chapters. And this is a very direct question we need to ask ourselves, we need to discuss, in regard to the question we asked. Remember the question we asked? We asked the question, who owns the divine prophecy? Who owns the divine inspiration? So here's the situation that someone is forced to a war, is involved with war, and is basically need to pick and choose the battle. Cheryl, can you please read? Thank you.
Hi, Ted. So can you hear me with this?
Yeah.
Okay. What I'm going to do, as Dr. Weisblum said, is just summarize in my words, which certainly aren't as effective as his, because the chapter is some...
You're speaking very fast. And you're not speaking far back.
Loud. It's on. Just okay. A little louder.
Okay. What I want you to do as I read part of these excerpts from Dr. Weisblum's memoir is I want you to think of questions, one, you might want to ask him, and then, of course, combined with what he just said, where is the divine will and prophecy? This section deals with the part where Michael is actually in training as a recruit to go join the army. The chapter starts 2 days before they are to graduate, when they get a special message saying they have to have a meeting immediately and they must show up in this building because the Minister of Defense is coming to talk with them. And he says, and in this part, I am going to quote from the writing, "You will need to engage some of the most ruthless terrorist cells embedded in schools, mosques, and even hospitals. They are terrorizing not only Israeli populations, but also Lebanese citizens." And remember, this is 1982 in the war in Lebanon. "You must act swiftly because the enemy moves rapidly, just as lice do. And it's impossible to wipe out all the lice at once. You need to be tough, determined, and vigilant at all times as you have been trained." The details were that they were to neutralize these combatants, destroy them. But as the minister went on, "Your mission is to also capture valuable intelligence, documents, and observations hidden from air surveillance. You will receive packets and details from your officers. We are proud of you, and I remind you of your training and our fundamental policy. Do your utmost not to harm civilians." They left, and the soldiers sitting there were awestruck, and Michael says, and I quote, "I realized how precarious, critical, and vital our mission was. I felt reinforced that I had made the right decision to leave my studies and help my country. And then Michael goes on for 4 or 5 pages describing how they leave their training section and are taken to the area in Lebanon where they need to be. This is January and February of 1982. They're first taken by submarine. They can go as far as it's possible. Then they have to swim in freezing waters and temperatures. Then they have to crawl on their stomachs under barbed wire to get through the hills and valleys of Lebanon. There they try to find a bunker where they could be camouflaged, but yet ready to attack when they were given the mission from headquarters. While they were waiting in this bunker, they were able to observe the militia and see some of the most cruel and horrendous acts that this militia performed to entertain themselves. I thought it was pretty gruesome, so I'm only going to share one part with you, where they would throw an animal down from the top of the building into burning fire and watch the animal suffer. What this caused the soldiers, the 11 of them there, was many of them became naturally upset, wanted to go out and attack them. But it was Michael who said, no, we need to stay here and be focused on our mission and plan what we were going to do. And again, going back, they're sitting there. They're already prepared, constantly dressed, ready to go in case, one, they have to escape, or two, the orders come from headquarters for them to begin their mission. While they're in there, two men come to the bunker, and obviously there's tension and nerves inside with, why are these people here? Who are they? And then again, to summarize what Michael has written in here, they give them a password and know these people knew who they were and that these were people who would collaborate with them. One was a priest, one was a former professor, and they said, again, I quote, our survival is dependent on you. Your army is the only one which we believe is strong enough to keep the Syrians and feuding factions under control. They continued talking and said on here, what the priest said, I am yearning for peace and unity in Lebanon that has been lost and for what could be. Is my world too fragmented to be repaired? Michael goes on to say, our suspicious, prejudicial attitude slowly disappeared. We realized their altruism while continuing a conversation with them. The professor stated, the Lebanese are an intelligent, peace-loving, and fairly secular people, but foreign terrorists have hijacked us with their cruel and inflexible doctrine against our way of life. Mike thinks about this and says, I was disturbed that I had not previously understood the cultural disparity, the religious and secular ruptures in Lebanon. Now I have begun to gain a new perspective with exposure to these ideas. The men leave with warnings of being safe and comfortable, and 2 days later, they get their orders to go out from the bunker. And Michael goes on to describe the elaborate plan they had so that two men could go in and get the papers that they needed for to bring back and make the mission a success, but also how they were going to plan diversionary tactics so that they could go in and disrupt the militia watching them. The problem was, this was uncharted territory. Things went wrong in the beginning. The diversionary explosion didn't work. Some of their men got hurt, and they had to act independently, quickly, and decide what to do. They scattered. Two of the men were wounded. One of the soldiers, whose name was Rafi, went on to use his gun to try to attack the snipers coming after them. Unfortunately, Rafi got badly injured, at which point Michael collapsed, was taken to the hospital, and wanted they after I back up, I'm sorry. Michael was able to take Rafi and the wounded soldiers to get to a helicopter so they could go out and get aid. At which point, then trying to carry Rafi, trying also to tell the helicopter where to land so that it would be safe from other attacks, he is exhausted, goes back to the bunker, and says, "This was my first realizing of what war is like." He's in the hospital and finally does come out of his unconscious state, and the first thing he asks is, "Where is Rafi? What happened to him?" The other soldier there says to him, "I'm sorry to tell you, it is heartbreaking that he passed away." The other person that was in the room with Michael at this time was Didi, the girl that he met, and I think you learned about that in the chapter last week, while he was going in the service, and his family befriended Michael the whole time they were in training. They appeared at the hospital and said, "We got your number and came immediately to see you in the hospital. I did not see any of your family members visiting you. Do you want us to call anyone for you?" I was embarrassed and lowered my eyes. Quietly, I responded, "I am sure my family knows. They just don't care to come. They disowned me when I joined the army. I have no family." Dee Dee's father put his hand on mine and said with a convincing voice, "It's a shame some parents destroy their children's soul instead of strengthening it. You are a well-mannered young man. Anyone should be proud to have you as a son. Our home is always open to you. We will always respect your opinions, even if they differ from ours. You don't need their approval anymore. Your family cannot control or manipulate you any longer. God put us on this earth to love and help each other. Everything else is minor." I was moved by his words and could only say two words: "Thank you." Previously, every step I made was criticized by one or more family members. It was a great feeling to be loved for who I was as a person and not to be continually disparaged. The chapter goes on to have Michael recover, and Michael says, "I need to go to Rafi's funeral." The doctor is able to give him bandages, medication. He goes to the funeral, and the chapter ends with Michael's description of Rafi's funeral.
Thank you very much. Okay, any question? Yes. Well, nobody justify war, for sure. Why? Okay, so for sure, from the ancient, she asked a question about the religious people, the religious attitude toward war. Right. Yes, that's the dialogue between Michael and his father in the book. That his father said, "You should not go to war because you should not murder people." And Michael said, "It's either us or them. If they're throwing missiles on us, we sit here like the Jews in the ghettos, we'll be sent to a cremation. You know, somebody needs to do something." And his father said, "You don't need to do it. Let God take care of it. Let other people take care. You need to sit and study." That's it. Not just a dilemma in the Jewish world. You can see it in every religion, in every faith. That's a serious dilemma of a war and the causes of war. War is a horrible thing for everyone. The problem of the holy war, jihad, or any holy war, is the idea that they're using the biblical text as a cause or as a result or as a justification to the war. Yes. Is someone raising hand? No question? That's good. No questions. Second time. Okay, so we continue. Yes.
I was very concerned about what you said.
Mm-hmm.
Who thinks that
close our
eyes to
the fact
that the
lady doesn't have this? Okay,
said,
so what I said is that.
Oh,
thank you. What happened is whenever a country like North Korea or a country like that made this attempt, I'm not speaking because I'm a prophet. I'm not speaking because I have divine inspiration. I'm not speaking because I have a political agenda. And I'm not speaking because I belong to embassy or Knesset or anybody whatsoever. I'm talking on behalf of myself only. My life experiences prove that when a big tyranny or big regime have an agenda, they are doing part of their agenda is a propaganda for certain reasons. An example. In the book I wrote, it's not published yet, I explained that the war in Lebanon in the 80s was diversion war. It's a drug, heavy drug war within the Lebanese friction, which means the Lebanese manufactured the best heroin, marijuana that distributed to Europe, and the Syria control it. And in order for Syria to control that, they used the Hezbollah and they used other forces to throw missiles on Israel and created international attention to that area in order to divert the world from the real drug war over controlling the drug. I think in that sense, it's a very similar to North Korea, because what happened in North Korea, it was a missile, it was a public domain, it was a public missile, and they showed the whole world that that missile messed up and didn't reach the goal that it's supposed to be. So gullible people who are not familiar with defense or not familiar with the military, they take it as a just, you know, situation that they messed up. People who are a little more educated know that it was fully intent in most of those cases to give a general idea to the world that US and the West exaggerating over North Korea ability. In that sense, the International Atomic Group and other group will leave them alone to continue on in their development. It's a different strategy when it comes to media exposure.
I don't blame them. Okay, thank you.
And if he could just return it in there.
You can take it or leave it.
Okay, I will. Thank you.
Yes, please. Okay, so what I try to show in this picture, thank you, it's something like either a combination of both or conflict of interest. This is a fellow that happened in the 10, 15 years in IDF, the Israel Defense Force. Before that, it was relatively rarely situation to see observant people serving, but it's more common nowadays. So you see a guy, they are doing some either mission or testing. Israel usually it's more than mission, more mission than testing. Thank you. So he was praying before another mission or before another big action. So it's like a combination of these two. Yes. But that was a different time. Okay, so let's go to our conclusion. What we try to cover today, first and foremost, is the definition of theurgy. You remember what is a theurgy? What theurgy means? Theurgy is basically Latin or Greek word that involving what? Conversation with God? A little deeper than conversation. It's the theory that speaks even more than that. It's not just dealing with God. It's the ability of people
transforming God's will. Do you have an impact? Does God have an impact?
Almost. Ability of people to influence the supernatural power to change his or her, whatever you call the beloved of God or Allah, will. That's theurgy. And theurgy is crucial to understand the whole philosophy of any religion. Because it's the point of departure that there is a supernatural power who created its creatures. And because those creatures are godly creatures, therefore they have spark of God that they can take and make ex nihilo, make something from nothing. Looks like godly thing, which creates sometimes the ego issues, but it's basically a person can influence something bigger than it's God. Now, in Buddhism, for example, there is a state of enlightenment in the whole concept of the Dharma, or the idea of getting enlightenment is by a self-purification. If a person is involved with a very deep meditation, is a involved in self-searching, etc., he or she reached the level of enlightenment that they themselves can change the whole perception of the world. And it starts with the person itself. That's Buddhism teaching. The other religion have structure of teaching, which is the whole concept of God. And because God, here you enter a very serious domain, which is when you say that God is transcendental, which means God is above and is no relationship to its creature, or you say that God is the living God, that it's in your dining room, care very deeply of what you're doing, of what type of food you're eating, or what you're dressing, etc. It's a very serious discussion. Because if you go by the school of thought that, for example, Hegel expresses beautifully, and many other philosophers, that God is a transcendental, which means God is creating something and he set up a world and then you leave it alone. It's like in the computer world, you set up business, the business set up and run well, then you go next step, right? And you leave the management and you leave the people alone and you're not involved with them. That's one school of thought, that God is in that sense, in our anthropomorphic language. Everybody know what is anthropomorphic? Raise your hand so I know that we are the same level. No, so I need to say it. Anthropomorphic meaning human language, which means we're using a human language in order to express things that otherwise we're not able to express. So when you see in the Bible the word ear of God, anger of God, fire of God, happiness of God, and all these attributes to God is an anthropomorphic language, is a language of people in order to understand attributes that we call God. So in that anthropomorphic language is the idea that God is transcendental, which means it's above. Either you call it in heaven, like you're like a little kid in the elementary school. Where is God? Oh, he's there over there. All right. Or some people, God is like the priest with the Santa Claus beard or whatever it is. It's a different image of what is God versus the school of thought that it's a living God, that it's involved in every small things in life. And why it's so crucial? Because if you're saying that God is transcendental and is disconnected himself, or that big entity, from the current events, then the whole perception of divine inspiration and prophecy is different. Versus if you say that it's a strong correlation between God and people, which is like the concept of partnership, concept of duality, concept of combination of homoreligiosity and cognitives, which is a combination of me being individual while I'm part of community, that two entities that combine in one duality, in one person, Carl Jung used this beautiful attribute. He says, like myself in a mirror, myself is individual, myself is part of the whole world. So in that sense, if God and people are one entity and they are partners in creation, therefore the next step is, who owns this divine inspiration and prophecy? Who is the one who has that right? So if you go by the very famous Saadia Al-Fayyumi, Rabbeinu Saadia Gaon, who lived in Egypt at the 9th century, he wrote in a book of a Faith and Beliefs, very interesting book, he wrote that the whole idea of God, God is the creator and he's interfering as long as people connected to him. Which means as long as you pick up the phone and talk to him, so you are connected. Otherwise, it's some type of disconnectedness. I don't disagree with that. So again, it's the same philosophy of those who said if you visit the house of worship or not, if you are more connected or less connected, if you can pray everywhere or not, if praying can change God's decision or not. If you follow the theological approach, which is the approach that the person is a part of the divine and therefore he can change God, so therefore a person can be potentially, everyone can be a prophet, can be a person of divine inspiration, can influence anything in God with his limitations. If you say that it's just a transcendental God, I'm not talking about agnostic or all the other theory that God is not existing. Those who hold that there is entities that whatever you call it, it's a beloved or God or Allah, whatever, it's a strong correlation between something that is the highest power than its creatures. So what exactly how the deal works? What's the relationship? Those of you who know a little bit in my life, I was heavily involved in the business world for many years. I used to do a consultant for business, building startup businesses, etc., for many years, international businesses. So when I was involved in the business world in those years, many times you go to those meetings as a consultant, and those days I just got my MBA, and I walk in the big meeting, and everybody expecting you to come and prophesize what's going to happen, how things going to turn. What you try to tell people in the world of the economy in general, that it's depending on so many components that you cannot have a who is a divine inspiration and prophecy tell the company how things are going to happen. You can use your life experiences, you can have an estimate, you can read the budget and understand it. If it's real estate, you know what is NOI and net operation income, gross operation income, what is the income and expenses, and you look clearly at the budget and then you read the numbers and you use years of experience and you could predict it, what's the percentage of vacancy and how the business is going to run. Or if you're in other businesses, you can have some experiences and read the map and can prophesy somehow, but that's a very dangerous path. Whenever I hear those people in the Federal Reserve or whatever it is, they're prophesizing what's going to happen, I never liked it, because studying economy, studying business administration and knowing how the business world works is the same as the theology of religion. It's dependent on so many components and it's so much involved with the interaction between people and interaction of the global economy that you cannot fully, honestly predict what's going to happen. And anybody who predicted something is destined for failure. So, in conclusion, what we learned today, you see, we learned a lot of things, I think. We learn first and foremost the definition of theurgy. And the theurgical approach is the idea that people as people have some ability to influence something bigger that is called the supernatural power. We understand that we cannot define the unlimited, but we can have some attributes which call anthropomorphic attributes, a human language attribute, to a big one that we call God. We also understand some ontological approaches, which is different approaches for different leaders of the world to the whole concept of using text. Some using it in a very cruel way, some using it for good, some using it for purposes of building a country or building a state or building something, and some others use it to destroy other parts of the world. So all these concepts of divine prophecy or divine inspiration prophecy, it's a very sensitive subject. And again, my little experiences in the army services I share with you today is just another small example of how the perception can constantly change according to interaction between people. And again, you ask your question, what exactly the divine involved with all of that? And it's a very painful question, and yes, I do not have a final answer to all those questions. Thank you very much. See you next week.